ओके एवरीवन, हाय, दिस इज प्रियंका फ्रॉम सिनर्जेटिक्स एंड आई वेलकम यू ऑल इन द लाइव सीरीज एज्योर पाइथन द वेबिनार ऑन डिप्लॉय मशीन लर्निंग मॉडल्स इन एज्योर फंक्शंस विथ पाइथन एंड टेंसर फ्लो। सो आई होप यू ऑल कैन हियर मी।
Yes, Priyanka.
So we will start with the introduction about the series and today's session. So today's webinar is held under and organized by Azure Tech Community and sponsored by Synergetics and Microsoft. So basically our community is open for all the people who are interested in Azure related technologies. So you just need to follow our meetup groups on Meetup, which is Emerging Technology Community and Azure Tech Community. This is Azure Tech Community is for Pune and ETC Meetup is for everyone who are interested in the technological related activities. So you can directly follow on this meetup. So you will directly get updated about our upcoming events, webinars and meetups through the meetup calendar. So this is a small code of conduct which you all need to follow. So you can't take the screenshots of the presentation which is shared by the speaker, and you cannot do the recordings of the session. If you need the recording, just let me know. We will share that with you. About the deploy machine learning models in Azure functions with Python and TensorFlow. So this is the agenda for today's session. You will get to know how machine learning models fits in the Azure functions and works with the Python and TensorFlow to consume the API from web app and HTTP API for classifying an image and functions with you will explore more Azure functions in Python. So the speaker for the today's webinar is Ms. Ashwini Shahane. So she is a Microsoft certified trainer and she is also working as a president of Synergetics IT Services for more than 20 years in Synergetics. So she always believes in keeping herself up to date with the latest technologies like VB, .NET, so the change in this, the trends and updating technologies like MOS, SQL, XML, and she's working on many projects of artificial intelligence, ML, and Python. So she is the best speaker for today's webinar to guide us about the different Python aspects. And she has more than 30 plus years of experience in this industry, and she has trained many employees from big Fortune companies like Intel, Microsoft, Accenture, Capgemini, and many more companies, not only from the India, but from the outside of the India, such as Sri Lanka, US, UK. And I am very less with the words to describe her great work and experience in this industry. And I'm sure she will solve your each and every doubt regarding the today's topic. So before moving forward with our session, I would like to tell you we have took three different initiatives in this COVID during this COVID situation. So we have started with three virtual series. One is Azure Python series. From this, we have already completed one webinar and one workshop. So today is the second webinar, and we are having our last workshop, second workshop tomorrow. So if you haven't registered or you want the attendee link for tomorrow's workshop, just let me know. Just mail me or WhatsApp me. We will share the attendee link with you. So tomorrow's workshop is a hands-on session, so you will get the all practical knowledge about the Python cloud native application with the Python. So tomorrow's session is from morning 10 to evening 5. The second initiative was live AI on Azure Meetup series, and we are done and completed successfully with this series, and all the four virtual meetup recordings are available on our YouTube channel. So I am going to share our YouTube channel link in the message box. So you can visit, and you can, if you haven't attended or want to re-attend this meetup, so you can easily get the recordings of this sessions. So also we host the DP series, which DP webinar series, certification ready webinar series. In that series, there are 3 webinars we have done. So that also are available on our YouTube channel. So you can just go through with the certifications. And now time to upgrade with the some certification. So we have started virtual training. So this is the calendar for virtual live training. So you will get all these trainings in just ₹17,500, which includes live training plus MOC and exam voucher. So this is the concerned person, Shilpa Awar. You can directly call her or email her, or also you can mail me your queries or doubts or inquiries. We will share with her. And if you want the detail calendar, also you can visit our company's website, synergeticsindia.com, so where you can find the calendar. So thank you once again. And regarding the Python webinar recordings, you will get that from our YouTube channel. But regarding the workshop recordings, we can't share the workshop recordings until the Microsoft given permission to us to share with them with you all. So we haven't received any kind of updates regarding that. So workshop recordings are not going to share yet. So if you want to attend tomorrow's workshop, please message me or mail me your details. Share the attendee link. And for the participation certificate for the today's webinar, we will share the feedback form. And if you, any one of you, haven't registered for the today's webinar, or you directly get the link from our social media or WhatsApp messages, please mail me your details, your name, your mail ID, so we can share the participation certificate with you. So once the webinar is over, we will share the feedback form, and after that we will share the participation certificate. So thank you once again. Now we will start with our session. Ashwini ma'am, we can start with the session now.
Thank you, Priyanka. Just give me 2 minutes and I'll share my screen. A very warm welcome to everybody to this session. Just give me 2 minutes. So I hope everybody can see my screen.
Not yet.
It's just loading now.
Yeah, now
okay.
It's gone back again.
It still is not visible.
Is this visible now?
Yeah.
Now we can see.
Yes.
So welcome to this webinar once more. And Priyanka has already introduced me. So my name is Ashwini. I am the president of the learning services in Synergetics. I'm also a Microsoft MCT, and I've also been working on Azure right from the time that Azure released. So today's session, right, before I actually start the session and take you through the session, I want to just highlight what the session is not about, okay, so that the expectations are set correctly. So this session is not a session for learning Python or learning functions, or for that matter, learning how to create models in Azure Machine Learning or TensorFlow. This session is understanding and opening our minds to how features or technologies like Azure Functions today can be used to host the machine learning models, and how they can very easily give you a very scalable hosting solution for your machine learning models, and then utilizing those models from your applications, right? So that is what this session is about. But though it is not about Python and functions and machine learning, because we are looking at a use case with all of these things involved, we will definitely look at why these particular technologies have been chosen to work together. So we will definitely look at why is Python one of the most popular languages for creating machine learning models today. Then we'll look at Azure Functions and what is it that Azure Functions brings in, right? Before we look at machine learning, a high level overview of what is machine learning and AI all about, plus what is the support for it in Azure. And then of course, we'll be looking at the core demo of this session, which is how do we deploy a machine learning model using Azure Functions. So Python for analytics and AI, a lot of people always ask why Python for AI, or which is the programming language which is best for AI, right? Now Python over the last few years, though it is a general purpose language, it has gained a lot of popularity as the choice of language for developing complex solutions, whether it is analytic solutions, big data analytics, or for that matter, machine learning and AI, right? So let's look at why is Python today gaining so much popularity, right? So if you look at Python, there are multiple reasons, right, why data engineers or data scientists prefer to use Python, right? So you need to write less code. You have a lot of pre-built libraries, which is of course supported through massive community support. It's platform independent, very important. And the learning curve for learning Python is not very steep. Okay? So let's look at each one of these. So when you talk about AI, you're talking about using algorithms to create models, train models, evaluate models, and then be able to deploy models, right? Python is a language because of the huge community support, right? It already has a lot of predefined packages, right? Where a lot of these algorithms are already, machine learning algorithms are already provided, right? So we really don't need to, code from scratch, right? We simply reference libraries, import libraries, and then start using the functions provided by those libraries. Secondly, Python also provides interactive mode for execution. So you can very easily, quickly try out things and see the execution and the result immediately. Like I said, it has a lot of pre-built libraries that implement different machine learning as well as deep learning algorithms. And some of the examples are libraries like NumPy, Keras, TensorFlow, PyTorch, and scikit-learn, and so on, right? So it's a very small command to just basically install and import the libraries into your code and start using it. So this is one strength that Python has. In fact, any new functionality, any new feature, right? If you look at most of the big data platforms also, or analytics platforms also, you'll see that they release new feature in Python first, and then they will release it in other languages like R and so on. It's a very, very, very simple language, right? So the syntax is, the core language is very simple, basic features, right? And you can write code, minimum code, to do your tasks, right? So it's a very it's not a very verbose kind of a language. So it's very easy to use and easy to learn. So that is another reason why it is gaining a lot of popularity. Most important, it is platform independent, right? So it is available on different platforms, Windows, Mac, Linux, right? So even while transferring code across platforms, it's pretty simple to ensure that your packages can be built for the other platform, right? So that is again something which gives or brings in the popularity. And then you have the massive community support, right? You have, like I said, lots of libraries being created. Any kind of errors you have, or any kind of help you require, you can always go to the community and you will immediately get responses to your queries, which is generally one of the limitations of an open source product, right? The open source product is that you don't have support. And that is why a lot of organizations or enterprises used to opt for branded or licensed products. But with Python, the community support is so extensive and so quick that even though it's an open source product, it is very, very easy to implement and get resolutions to any problems that you may be facing. Now, because we are going to look at basically analytics or rather machine learning or deep learning solution, right? Python has a lot of libraries that are related to that. So some of the popular ones I have just listed here, right? So we have NumPy, which is one of the core libraries which let you do mathematical computations and provides you with functionalities for that. You also have Pandas, which is another library in Python, which basically helps you work with data sets and helps you load data, explore data, go and do data transformations, right, and so on. Scikit-learn is a library which is having machine learning algorithms. It is one of the easiest libraries to start off with when you are new to machine learning, right? It has a lot of basic data sets as well as machine learning algorithms that it comes with. While Scikit-learn is more about the core machine learning and algorithms that are provided there, like classification or regression algorithms and so on, TensorFlow is more about deep learning, right? This was a library developed by Google, right? So it is popular for its neural network based algorithms, which are mainly used in building deep learning models. So whether it is, image classifications and things like that, where you require multiple model layers, right? And which kind of ape the way our brains work, neural networks, that's what TensorFlow provides us with. So the model that we are going to use today for doing image classification is actually been developed using TensorFlow. Then we have libraries like Theano, Keras. Okay, Theano is again more from array and data data exploration perspective or compute perspective. Keras is more about visualization and of course evaluating and working with data. NLTK is for natural language processing, NLP. Right, so any kind of text-based analytics you want to do, right, whether it's text mining and so on, it is a good library that you can use in Python. Now, these are just a few that I have listed. There are huge number of libraries that are available in Python, right? These are just some of the popular ones that I've listed for doing a work which provide you with basic you would say collection APIs and basic Python APIs and data set based APIs and data exploration and data transformation based APIs to libraries like scikit-learn, which provide machine learning algorithms and so on. And then you have libraries like TensorFlow or NLTK, which are more deep learning libraries with deep learning algorithms. And so Python is core today, is being used or is very popular today as the language for machine learning. So let's look at what is function apps all about. So we've looked at Python, but if I have to write Python code and if I have to execute it, I need some hosting environment where I'm going to execute that code. Now, what is Azure Function Apps in Azure, right? So Azure Function Apps was created more for creating this serverless computing experience for customers on the Azure platform. I'm sure everybody is familiar with this, with the terms of serverless computing, right? Serverless computing is where you write a piece of code and you are not really bothered about the infrastructure or the computer environment on which that code is going to execute, right? So you simply want to write the code and deploy it to the cloud, and at runtime or whenever required, whenever it is invoked, it will automatically go and provision the required compute infrastructure and execute that code on that infrastructure, right? So when is that code going to get triggered, right? So typically in serverless computing solutions, there are something known as triggers or events, which will basically go and invoke a particular code, piece of code to be executed. So you react to maybe an HTTP request, you may react to some kind of events that may occur based on certain services that are there on Azure. For example, Azure has a blob storage service. So maybe whenever a file is uploaded to the blob storage, it could trigger some code to execute, a function to execute, right? Or it could be timer-based, it could be scheduled execution, right? So something which will trigger the code execution, right? So that is one part of serverless computing. Then of course the main piece, which is the actual code, right? Which is going to execute. And that is what Azure Functions are all about. So Azure Functions are about writing piece of code, right? That will get triggered or executed by some kind of event, which is timer based or, you know, based on some request that comes in and so on. Now this code that is there, this function that is there in Azure, supports multiple languages and platforms, right? So you can write code in C#, you can write code in F#, Node, Java, Python, even scripting languages are supported for writing your code. And then of course, you can send, once the function or that code is processing that information, you could also have a binding to an external store or to some external, maybe, you know, send it to some other application and so on. So you can have output based bindings, like you have events which will trigger the function and will maybe pass some data. And about, so you have input bindings that the code will have to the data that is being passed by the event triggers. Similarly, you have output bindings. So if it's, for example, if you're responding to a simple HTTP request and the function is executing when an HTTP request comes in, your output could be a simple HTTP response, right? Or if, let's say, it's getting triggered based on some file getting uploaded, maybe a CSV data file getting uploaded to Azure storage, right? The function could be reading the data from the file, processing it, and then maybe pushing the data to some kind of a store like a SQL database or a Cosmos DB, right? Or it could be, let's say, based on some event or some maybe a notification that comes in, the function app could actually go and notify or by sending some email or something to somebody. So this is how it gets bound, right? So serverless computing is all about code. You're writing code where you really don't care about the server or computer environment on which it's going to execute. It is typically triggered through some event, right? And it will normally go and put some process information out to some output target. So function could run based on HTTP requests. It could be scheduled to run at a particular time. It could run whenever maybe new documents are added to Cosmos DB, or so blobs are added to storage, or a message is added to a queue, right? So these are all services on Azure which could trigger a function to get executed. You can also have your own custom applications that can, you can build the entire event framework using Azure Event Grid, right, which is a service in Azure which lets you define or set up the connectivity between an event publisher and an event subscriber. So you can do that. You could be getting events from, device or sensor through IoT hubs, right? So you could be receiving huge messages on IoT hubs which could trigger off execution of some functions. Right, so there are many, like I said, triggers that are supported on Azure functions. So it is basically some piece of code, what we define as a function, that is going to run somewhere on the cloud. It is simply business logic that you're implementing, some processing logic that you're implementing without bothering about the actual plumbing code for where it's going to execute, right? So the hosting environment and so on. Like I said, it supports multiple programming languages. It also supports scripting languages like PowerShell and Shell Scripts and Unix. So in from .NET, you have support for Java, so .NET Core, C#, Java, PHP, Python, yeah, JavaScript. And we saw the different integrations which could lead to invocation of the function or lead to the function sending information to something. So all these could trigger, all these services on Azure could trigger the function to execute. These are, of course, integrations with the other services on Azure, but you could also trigger it through HTTP requests. You could also trigger it through timer-based schedules. Remember that. So we saw what is a trigger, right? Trigger is something that will maybe be executed on some event that occurs, and it will go and trigger the execution of that function when that event occurs. And these are the different types. We've already looked at it, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. Now, of course, when we write Azure functions, we are not really bothered about what environment it is going to execute on, right? But ultimately, somebody has to create that environment. So there are multiple hosting models that are available on Azure for hosting Azure functions, right? So there are basically two types of plans. You have a consumption-based plan or you have an app service-based plan. Actually, along with consumption, you also have one more plan, which is a premium plan, right? So you have consumption, premium, and app service-based plan, right? So these are the three options that you have for hosting functions. Consumption and premium, right, are basically what is known as elastic premium. They are basically plans which are serverless, right? Where you are not really paying for the compute environment in which that function is going to execute. You are paying for whatever time that execution is going to happen. So you're going to pay for the compute only for the period that the function is executing dynamically, right? So the function, whenever it is triggered, right, that's when it will dynamically get deployed somewhere on some compute environment where it's going to get executed, right? Now, because this is going to be managed by Azure, the complete plumbing for the compute environment for the function is going to be managed by Azure. Even the scalability factor is going to be managed by Azure, right? So consumption-based deployments are automatically scalable, right? So you have auto scale. So depending on what is the load that your function is having, how often it is getting triggered, how many instances are getting triggered, right? Based on that, it will automatically scale the compute to ensure that it can serve the requests that are coming in. And you are charged, of course, based on what compute time your function was executing for. Like you have consumption-based plan, like I said, you have even a premium plan, which is also dynamically instantiated compute environment. The difference is that over there, in case of consumption-based plan, if for some period, right, your function is not accessed, right, that function may get deprovisioned, right, and next time whenever there is a call to the function, it'll again go and provision it. Right? So it may get completely deactivated and deallocated, the entire compute environment, when the function is not being used. So there may be some amount of time that may go if the function has got deprovisioned and the next call that comes in, for it to, you know, kind of provision and then execute the function, it may take some time. In case of premium, it will hold or keep the function running for a longer period of time. So your function is typically running always, right? So that cold start time is no longer there. It's a warm start. It's already running. It's already on the computer environment, deployed on the computer environment. So the execution is faster, right? There are other functionalities that are supported, of course, with premium plans. So if you want to integrate, for example, your function with maybe virtual networks on Azure, you can do that, right? So there are a lot of these other benefits that you get with the premium plan. But both consumption and premium, that is Elastic Premium Plan for Function Apps, are a dynamic model, dynamic provisioning. So you pay only for the consumption. You pay only for whatever compute time, whatever calls your function gets. So whatever calls are made and however long it took to execute that function, that much is what you're going to pay. That compute is what you're going to pay for. But on the other hand, let's say you have already, like in Azure, you have something known as an app service plan, which is like a dedicated hosting environment that you can create, where you can go and deploy different types of applications, right? So over there, you're paying for the hosted environment. So you may host, you may decide what is the size of the compute you're going to have and what kind of resources you're going to have, and you're paying for that compute, you're paying for that VM, right? But you could deploy how many ever functions, how many ever web applications, how many ever API applications you want. So you can go and deploy any type of applications to that app service hosting plan. Because you're paying over there for the compute, you can then go and deploy whatever you want on that VM that you own, that you're paying for. Right? So, so if you already have a app service plan for hosting some applications and the compute power is not getting utilized completely, you may choose to even deploy your functions to the same plan. So that is also another option that you have. Right? The type of plan, of course, like I said, will control how the instances are hosted and scaled out, and what kind of resources are going to be available for the host. So consumption of premium, the scaling is automatic. You don't have to bother, right? But premium, it is going to be running continuously. So you're going to have, you know, no cold starts and so on. Consumption, it if not utilized for some time, it may land up the deprovisioning the function, in which case you will need, the next time it's called, it will have to, you know, do a start again, and it may take some time for it to deploy and execute. While in the app service plan based deployment, you have the control of how you want to scale. So app service has two scaling options. You can scale up or you can scale out, right? To multiple instances of that compute. So you can define that, and based on that, you can also define what is the size of the compute that you're paying for, the virtual machine that you're paying for, which will also determine what kind of resources your function will have. So let's look at the different hosting options that are there. So what we have discussed. In the development environment, if you're developing on your local machine, you can use Azure Function Core tools, right? Which is a SDK that you download and install. So you can actually, you know, create functions, run them locally, test them locally, and so on, without having to actually use Azure at all, right? Of course, to write the code and all, you can use your, you know, favorite editor. You can use something right from Notepad to Notepad++ to even editors today, which are popular, like Visual Studio Code, right? And Visual Studio Code is an editor that will again work on any platform, right? It's platform neutral, right? So you can use the Azure Function Core tools, install them, install your Visual Studio Code editor, and then start developing and testing functions. You can package the function, or you can deploy the code directly to the platform, or you could package it into a container and then deploy the container. So on local, both are supported, and both operating systems, whether it is Windows, Mac, Linux, all are supported, right? From a hosting perspective, right, if you're actually going to deploy it to Azure, right? So from a hosting perspective, we have three options like we saw. We have consumption, we have premium plan, and we have app service plan, right? So these three are available. In case of consumption plan and premium plan, you can only deploy code, the function code directly, right? If you want the option of deploying a container, then you will need to use the app service plan. Though I believe recently in premium plan also, they have added support for Linux containers, but it is only there now, I think. So that is also available. Consumption plan supports both Linux-based code as well as Windows-based code, right? So you could deploy to Linux or Windows platform. App service plan again supports both Linux as well as Windows. And a premium also today supports Linux as well as Windows. This is an older slide, so it does support both. You also can deploy functions. Like in this scenario, both consumption plan and premium plan are going to be executing in a serverless mode, right? Similarly, you can even have Azure functions deployed to other types of platforms. For example, you can deploy it to IoT Edge. You can deploy it to a Kubernetes cluster or maybe Azure Service Fabric, right? You can do that. Non-Azure, these are hosts, these are services on Azure where you can host function apps. Non-Azure, you can deploy it to maybe any virtual machine, right? Or any other Kubernetes implementation, right? Or if you have Azure Stack on premise, you can deploy it to an app service on Azure Stack, correct? Now, IoT edge, similarly, Kubernetes and Service Fabric, as well as, you know, non-Azure hosts, all support container-based deployments only, okay? And all support only Linux. Currently, they don't support Windows. And so you have a rich choice of how you want to deploy your functions, depending on what language, what platform you use to develop it, and you know, what functionalities of scale and usage you want. So an example of, you know, again, using functions for deploying machine learning models is today IoT Edge is there. Rather than having the data come from the IoT devices or sensors to the cloud where they will, you know, get analyzed, the data will get analyzed, especially in real-time analysis, right, where you would have maybe some model created and you're doing predictions based on that model. Today, with IoT Edge, you can actually take that analytics code closer to the device rather than executing it in the cloud. Now, if I'm going to execute that model inside, you know, or closer to the device using IoT Edge, then I can again host them using functions, right? Like what we are going to see today. Right, so any questions? So I'll just okay. So I'm assuming no questions. So let's continue. So let's look at how do you build Azure function using Python, right? Now, typically when you're building an Azure function using Python, your function project folder, right, would look something like this, right? So you would have underscore app underscore as the project folder. You would that project folder, of course, will contain subfolders for every function that project or that app is hosting, right? So the function app can have more than one functions, right? At the project folder, you have local settings.json file, which is basically going to store information for executing the function on your local machine. So this is used typically in the development time. So when you're developing the function, right, you can store, you know, certain settings that you are going to use in the local settings.json file. Now this file is not published when you deploy the code to Azure, right? Requirements.txt is a file which contains basically the list of Python packages that you may want to install on the environment where you want your code to run. So for example, if my code is using, let's say, functions from scikit-learn package, or if my code is using functions from TensorFlow, right? I would want these packages to be installed on the environment. So requirements of TXT will contain the list of packages that need to be installed on the environment, right? Locally, if I'm running it, I can, you know, create a virtual environment and I can call the pip install to, you know, install whatever is defined in the requirements.txt file. Then I have host.json, which basically contains any global configurations that you would want to do at your function app level. So this will be available to all functions within the function app, right? Of course, this file is not used locally. It is used only when you deploy it to Azure. Function ignore file, this is what will contain information about which are the files which are there in that folder, which should not be published to Azure when you deploy it to Azure. Similarly, git ignore, right? These are files that will have to be ignored or not synchronized with your Git repository if you're using that. And then you have a Docker file, which is again optional. This is basically if you are going to package a function as a container, then the Docker file is created so that you can then go and package it and deploy the create a container image, right, based on the Docker file. And then that image is published to a repository from where it can be then used to create or deploy the function app. So these are the file in the main project folder. Your, like I said, your project folder can contain multiple folders for if, so there'll be one folder for every function that is part of that project, that is part of that app. So every function folder will also have a file called function.json. It'll have the file, which is the script file that will be the containing the entry point of your function. Typically in Azure functions where Python is concerned, this file is underscore init underscore dot py, right? So that is the file that is defined. And function.json will define these things like what is the entry point, what are the bindings for your functions. So what are the triggers that your function is going to respond to? What are the output that your function is going to have and so on, right? Now, Visual Studio Code, like I said, is an environment where you can very easily create Azure functions and then deploy them to the Azure cloud, right? And it supports, again, multiple languages. So you could create the functions in Python, C Sharp, even Node and so on. So let's see how to create a basic function app using Python, and we'll use Visual Studio Code as the IDE for that. I'm not sure what you mean, Dharmaraja, when you say proxy authentication with applications, because here we are not talking about an application. Here we are talking about a piece of code that we are deploying. So I'm going to go to Visual Studio Code, right? And I'm going to create a new folder. Let's open a folder. So I'm going to go to this folder called demo one and select it. Now, if you see this folder, this is an empty folder. Currently, this folder doesn't contain anything, right? So let me go back to Visual Studio. Now, let me do one thing. Let me close this folder. Let me show it another way. So before I can start working with functions in Visual Studio Code, I need to install the appropriate extensions in code. So if I go to extensions, right, you will see that there is first Python for Visual Studio Code extension that is installed. Right, so Python language extensions for Visual Studio Code. And then you'll see there is a Azure Functions extension for Visual Studio Code that I have installed. Right, so you need to have these extensions installed. Right, then if I go to Azure, right, over here, I can go and create, because I have the functions extension installed, I'm seeing functions over here. I can go and create a new project, right? If I click on create a new project, it'll ask me to select the folder. So I'm going to select demo one. Now it's asking me, it's going to take me through the process of creating the skeleton of that application. So it's asking me which pipe, which language do you want to use? So you'll notice all these are supported, right? So I'm going to select Python. Which version of Python do you want to use? Which library version? I have 3.7.4, so I'm using that. There are different templates that are available for projects based on how the function code is going to get triggered. So which triggers, which bindings are supported. So I'm going to use an HTTP trigger. And it's asking me for the function name. So let me call this as I'm calling this as ng-event-demo-1. Authorization level. Now, if I'm deploying things to Azure, then functions will also have a key which will be have to be used to be able to access that function. So not just anybody and everybody will be able to go and access that function. You can, you know, protect that function with a key and then only allow access based on that. Currently, I'm going to allow anonymous. So I'm setting it as anonymous and I'm opening it in the current window. So it's going and creating this project. And if you see that folder, yeah, you'll see that it was an empty folder, but there are a lot of files that I've got created. Right? So you'll see files like function ignore, git ignore, host.json, local settings, proxies, right? And then you have the actual function folder. And inside that function folder, you have your init and you have your function.json. It also has a sample.dat. We really don't need that. That's just to indicate that you could have your own custom files also deployed to your project folder. So you have your own code or helper code files and so on that are there. You could deploy them to the folder. Okay. So if I go back to Visual Studio Code and if I look at the folders in demo one now, you can see it is showing me all the content, right? So I have these files. So for example, it ignores this in functions of deploying to Azure. These files are ignored, right? Git, ignore host.json, local settings. So currently just setting my runtime to Python, right? Requirements.txt, currently just loading Azure functions library, Python library, right? And inside my function, of course, the main code file, which is init.py. But before that, if I open function.json, which is what is going to contain the bindings for my function, you'll see over here it's specifying what is the script file, right? Now, normally, whichever is the script file specified, default is this init file, but you could change this. Now, whichever is the script file specified, when it has to execute the function, it will try to look for the method main within that script file, right? So if I look at init.py, you'll see that it has this method called main, right? So if you don't have a main method and you want to make some other method as the entry point, you can do that by specifying the entry point parameter also. Custom entry point parameter also. Then bindings, right? It's defining bindings. So in this case, it is saying it. The binding type is HTTP trigger. It's an input type of binding. It's going to receive something called as request, right? It can support both get and post. Of course, these properties that you're specifying, right, will depend on what type of trigger you are binding it to. So you're binding it to a blob storage trigger. These values will be different from what we are seeing because it's a HTTP trigger. Okay. And then what is the um, second binding that we have. In this case, the direction is out. So it's an out, not an input binding, an output binding. Type is HTTP, right? And it's going to return something called as $return. Okay. So function.json is an important file because that is what defines the interactivity of your function. Now coming to init.py, because we have specified that the input trigger is an HTTP trigger where it's going to receive request as a parameter, the main method, right, also receives this parameter. Okay, here it's explicitly saying it's a HTTP request. You can do that so that you can get the IntelliSense in Java, in Python. But even if you don't specify that, it will work. And the output, of course, is function.http response, right? So you can customize this. Now, what this is basically doing is first is looking at the query string parameters and checking there's a parameter called name, right? If that name parameter is there, right? So it's simply returning as a response, hello, concatenated with that name, right? If that name is not there, then it is responding with, please pass a name to the query string or in the request body. First is checking for the name parameter in query string. If it's not found in query string, it's looking for it in the request body because it could be a post request instead of a get request, right? And if it doesn't find it, right, it's giving an exception error. So it's it's saying in case there is an error, let it pass, right? But if there is a request body, then look for name, right? So it's a very simple function that is there. So let's try executing this function, right? So we'll go to run and start debugging. Yeah, and you can see it has gone and hosted the function and it is exposing an endpoint at port 7071 slash API slash whatever was my function name, right? So let's select this and let's try to invoke it. Now notice when I don't pass anything, it is giving me please pass a name on the query string or the request body, which is this I have to close this, right, which I'll show it to you later, which we had seen already. If I want to, I can pass a query string parameter. Right, so I'm passing the parameter name with a value of everybody. And now notice the function returns, hello everybody. And in the log that is generated for the function, you can see these getting called. Right, you can see these functions getting called. So it's logging this, logging each and every call to the function. Okay. So let's stop this. Now I was running this locally within Visual Studio Code. I could even go and deploy this to Azure as a function app, right? And I can deploy also directly through Visual Studio Code. So if I go to Azure function extension. Before I can deploy, you'll see there is an option deploy a function app from here. So before I can deploy, I'll have to sign into Azure. So let me click on sign into Azure. So it takes me to a browser page. It's asking me to enter my credentials, which is associated with the Azure account. And it is signed in now. I can close this. If I go back to Visual Studio Code, it'll actually go find out what are the subscriptions I have access to. I have access to a lot of subscriptions, as you can see. Right now, I want to deploy this function. So I can go to deploy to function app. Right. So where do I want to deploy? I want to deploy to this subscription. So I select that. Do I want to create a new function app in Azure? Now this will create whatever name I give. It will create all the resources using that name. There are a lot of resources that will get created, and we'll see what they are. In this scenario, I can define what resources should get created. Right. So for example, if I type in this as the function app name, it will ask me which environment, so Python. Which plan do I want to select? So I'm currently selecting the consumption plan. Which resource group do I want to deploy it in also on Azure? So I'm going to create a new resource group. Let me call this as RG to indicate it's a resource group. And then it also uses storage account. So functions, when you deploy to Azure, we should have a storage account associated with it. So that things like, storing files or storing the logs and all are done through that storage account. So let me create a storage account. So let's call it as SynG. For some reason, my Visual Studio Code has a problem deploying to with this. So I'll just do the default deployment. It asked me where do I want to deploy it, which location. I selected Southeast Asia, and now it's going in deploying my code. So if I go to my portal, so this is my portal. If I go to resource groups, let's sort it out. You'll see that this resource group has got created. So what it does is it creates a resource group with the same name as my function. Inside that resource group, it will go and create a storage account and the function and also an application settings. HTTPS also, both. So HTTP request could be either HTTP or HTTPS. Right, and here you can see that if you see the output window, we have created the storage account, right? It created the application insights, then it's created the function. And now it's deploying the files into the function app. So if I go back to my project and just refresh this. Refresh the resource group, you'll see the storage account is created, the app service is created, the application insights is created. So it is. And it says it is completed. Let me view output. And notice it tells me this is the URL for my, this is the endpoint for triggering my function. So if I fire a request to this endpoint, when I was running it locally, the request was going to localhost 7071. That's where it was hosting that function, right? /API/function name. In this case, it is going over here. This is the, so you'll see this is the app service where the function is deployed. So whatever function name dot azurewebsites.net /API/function name. So I can copy this and go to my browser. Yeah, and you'll notice over here it's HTTPS by default. Run it. And notice it's giving me the request saying you can pass a query string. So let me pass my name and it gives me the response. So this, I was running it locally, right? This I'm now deployed to Azure and I'm running the function from Azure. If you look at the deployment on Azure, if I go into that function app, right, it shows me what kind of a plan was selected and so on. And then if I go to functions, right, it gives me some metadata about the function execution, how many times it executed, how many times it succeeded, failed, and so on. I can also get the URL of the function from here. Okay, so I can use this service. Okay, is this clear? So we saw a simple example of how to use Azure functions and how you can create an Azure function using Python. And then how do you create it locally, execute it locally, and then how you can deploy it to Azure. Okay? So the next thing that we're going to look at is machine learning and AI on Azure. Right. So just a brief look at what is possibility on Azure, and then we'll actually see how to host a machine learning model inside a Azure function. So what is it that makes AI possible? Right. Earlier, you had predictive analytics was traditionally you had something known as a rule-based models. Rule-based models is where you use rules to define certain outcome of behavior. So for example, traffic light, you know, when should it turn green, when should it turn red, yellow. So you will have rules defined which will determine, predict how the traffic light should change color to avoid a traffic jam, right? It was typically built using, you know, some data, structured data, right? But as of course the complexity of the rules increased over a period of time, the number of rules itself will make that model very, very complex. And it required people with the domain knowledge to build those rules, to understand those rules, and then create that predictive predictive system, right? So this will work only, like it says, when you know each and every possibility, each and every situation, and you build in all that into the system. So let's say like a game, you're creating a model for a game, right? Like a chess game. Now for that, you will have to know each and every move, each and every possibility, probability of the what kind of moves, what kind of games will be there to be able to create this kind of a model, right? And it's a very tedious model as the complexity increases. The new models that we have, right? And this also is not something really new. It's been there for now decades, correct? But earlier it was limited to only certain set of people who had that knowledge which was required for building these models. And because of the very, very high compute resource requirements, right? It was not really something which was mainstream. Yeah, you required huge amount of compute, you require large, very large supercomputers to be able to compute them and so on. With the advent of cloud, with the storage cost on cloud becoming really, really cheap, with the compute scalability on the cloud becoming almost limitless, right? Cloud really opened up the gates for taking these kind of solutions to the main market, right? So the new models, which are machine learning based models, are where the machine will learn based on the past data, right? So what data you give to the machine is also going to be very important, very critical. And the machine will start identifying patterns in that data, and it will identify in a way what could be the rules, right? That should be there in that model, right? And create a model which will be able to then predict if new data is given, what could be the possible outcome. But this is not where you have to think up of all the rules, all the possibilities, and then program it. Here the machine will automatically learn based on the patterns in the data and the results, past results that you have given it. What is machine learning? It's where computer systems become smarter with experience. And how do you get experience? Past data and human input, right? So past data, and what was the outcome of that data? What was the result of that data? The human input, that is what will build that experience. And that's exactly how we also think, isn't it? Most of our reactions today to any situation is based on some experience we've had in the past in a similar situation. Either we have gone through it or we've seen somebody go through it. So similarly, machine learning is all about the machine learning from the patterns, the data in the data, and understanding what could be the possible result given a certain set of data elements. So what are the kind of problems you can solve with ML, right? So machine learning problems can be, you know, divided into different categories, right? So one category is how to classify something, right? Is something a dog or a cat or a spider, right? Or it could be something like, it's a bird, but what type of bird is it? Is it a pigeon? Is it a crow? Is it a sparrow? Right? All these are classification problems. Getting data and being able to classify it as of a certain type, right? That is what is a classification problem. Now, classification could be of two types. It could be binary classification. That means there are only two possible results, right? So for example, given the data of individuals, right, and their medical history, you need to build a machine learning model which will predict whether they are likely to have a heart attack in the future or not. Now the answer would be yes or no. So it's a binary classification problem. But you could have multi-classification problems also, multi-class classification problems also. type of problem, or is a regression problem. That is, when you want to predict some definite value, right? How much or how many, like what will be the price of a product given certain features, right? Or what should be the premium value of an insurance given the past bank records as well as past behavioral patterns of a person, right? Now you are actually setting a value, a numeric value, right? And that is what is known as a regression problem, right? Then you have an anomaly problem where you want to find out what is not, or what is away from normal, right? So typically things like your fraud detection is an anomaly problem. So you create a model for fraud detection. It's an anomaly problem you're trying to solve. Then you have clustering, or shall I say basketing items together, right? Based on certain features. So for example, a lot of your recommendations, for example, today if you go to any e-commerce site, you buy or you search for an item to buy, and then you will get below recommendations of similar items which other people have bought, right? So how do they do this? They classify you and put you in some bucket based on some characteristics that they have about you. So they try to, bucket people with the same characteristics together. And now when I'm buying an item, they look at that bucket and see the other people in that bucket and what kind of items have they bought, and show it to you as a recommendation. Right? So that's the clustering pattern, as we call it. And then we have reinforcement learning, where it's a continuous learning process. Based on the result, right, it will again go and regenerate a model, relearn the model, right? And so like a computer teaching itself how to play chess, right? Every game it plays, it will get better because it will be reinforcing whatever learning it has got from the previous game. Right? So these are the kind of patterns that you can solve with ML. Now, if you look at a typical machine learning solution, right, there is a technique which we just saw. It could be classification, it could be regression, it could be whatever, right? Now there are many algorithms, right, which will be able to solve a particular type of problem. So if it's a classification problem, there are many ways in which you can classify or arrive at the result, right? So the different methods that are used for processing that data and solving the problem, right? Other algorithms, right? So for example, for classification, you can use something known as decision tree, right? This is a classification algorithm. And then using the algorithm, when you train the algorithm using data, and the algorithm learns and identifies pattern in that data, what you generate is a model. So when you apply an algorithm to some data, right, what you get is the trained model, which should be able to then predict, given new data, what would be the result based on its learnings of the sample data that was given. If you look at artificial intelligence as an entire whole, right, machine learning is a subset of AI, right? And within machine learning, there are different types of machine learning algorithms or problems that you're trying to solve. Now, you also have something called as deep learning, right? A deep learning is where these patterns are observed continuously in multiple layers. Right? So first time it gets the input, there is one layer of processing that is done. Then based on the learnings of that layer, the second layer of processing is done. Based on that learning, the third layer of processing is done. So there are multiple layers that are there in case of deep learning. Right? look at something like image processing, right? When an image is given to the model, it'll first just look at what are the edges, or what are the distinct shapes that are there, or what are the edge lines that are there, and it'll just simply identify that, right? Then it'll try to put these different lines and shapes together to identify some kind of a feature, right? So maybe a nose or an eye or a ear, right? And then it will again process this layer and see how it can put these together to define a face, right? So you'll see that there are multiple layers of processing that happen in case of a deep learning model. So if you look at it, deep learning is in fact another subset of machine learning, where you will have multiple layers of machine learning to generate that deep learning model. Now, how does Microsoft Azure support AI development, or what are the services it has for AI, right? So we look at services, we look at infrastructure, we look at tools, right? So if you look at services, it has Azure Machine Learning, which is a service on Azure, which lets you build machine learning models. So it supports the entire end-to-end life cycle of building a model, of training a model, of evaluating a model, scoring a model, right? This and all these steps, and then of course deploying. So train a model, score a model, evaluate a model, and deploy a model. All these steps can be done using Azure Machine Learning, right? And today Azure Machine Learning supports Python as the first class language, using which it will be able to, you'll be able to code using Azure Machine Learning. Similarly, you also have some pre-built models that are available as services on Azure, which are cognitive services. And then you can build intelligent applications using some of these cognitive services using chatbot or bot frameworks on Azure. Now, to be able to build models, or to be able to host these kind of applications, you require huge amount of compute, storage, and so on. So Azure has a lot of services related to compute, storage. One of them, of course, is your Azure Functions. And then it also supports multiple tools. So you have multiple IDEs like Visual Studio Code, you have Visual Studio, you have ML Studio, which is again a visual tool, right? And then it supports multiple languages and frameworks, right? So all third-party frameworks, whether it's TensorFlow, CAFE, scikit-learn, Keras, all are supported. Microsoft's own cognitive toolkit is also supported. The two core services that are related to machine learning, of course, is Machine Learning Studio and Machine Learning Service. But what do they provide, right? What they provide is an end-to-end solution for, like I said, the entire machine learning model creation and deployment, right? From ingestion of data, preparation of data, features, feature engineering, and so on, to building of the model, to training and testing the model, right, which is scoring the model, evaluating the model, right, to building a deployable image of the model, which is typically a Docker image, right, with all the dependencies defined in it, to actually deploying the model to some kind of a hosted environment. So it could be a Kubernetes cluster, it could be a function app, it could be, you know, multiple options that you have. So ML service provides you with functionalities to do each and every part of this. No, not really. Reinforcement learning is not same as deep learning. Reinforcement learning is when you learn. So the model is continuously learning. So as new predictions are made, as new data is infused, it'll keep, you know, taking that new data and relearning or recreating the model. Right, that is what it means. So Azure Machine Learning, like I said, it has steps for doing each one of these, right from training the model to managing the models that are created, right from doing things like version management for models to creating your inference code or what is known as your scoring files through your editors to be able to create the images which can be used to deploy your models, to deploying it to different deployment environments, and then in the end being able to monitor and manage the deployments. So all this is possible using Azure Machine Learning, right? Now we are not going to really look at creation of machine learning models, but I wanted you to understand what are the different things that you can do using Azure Machine Learning. Now one of the aspects which is important in Azure Machine Learning is the deployment, right? How are the models that are created going to be deployed? And that's what we're going to look at now with Azure Functions and ML. So if you look at machine learning, if you look at the end-to-end solution, like I said, right from preparing the data to creating and choosing the model to deploying the model, these are the core steps that are done, right? Your data processing also requires a huge amount of compute. And then when the model is created, also you require something where the model can be hosted, right? So Azure Functions can be used in multiple areas. Now, typically data processing and model creation is done by the data scientists, and typically model deployment is done by the developer, AI developer. Also, data processing, some part of it is there with the AI developer, because if you want to, you know, recreate the models, retrain the models, you want the new data to be collected, all that would be responsibility of the AI developer, right? Now, whether it is data processing, whether it is model deployment, both cases you can make use of Azure Functions, right? In our session today, we are going to concentrate more on deployment of the model using Azure Function, right? So just the sample workflow of creating a deep learning model using TensorFlow, Keras, right, with Azure Machine Learning and how it would flow, right? So you would define your model training code, right? So based on the data, based on the features that are created, which are passed as input, right? The model training will happen. Yes. Model training will happen, right? There are dependencies for running that model, right? So the dependencies are also taken care of. So this model, once it is created, right, once it is trained, and once you have evaluated which model you want to deploy, along with the model and the dependencies, you'll go and create the container, and that can be then deployed or hosted wherever you want. So this is typically the reference architecture that you follow. What we are going to do in today's demo is there is a model created, okay, using TensorFlow to classify images. And if we're going to try and classify images as a cat or a dog, and it has been trained using certain images. So we're going to try and use this model that is created to do the classification. So let's try doing this. Now, last time I created the function using Visual Studio Code. This time I'm going to do it using Azure Function code libraries. Okay. core libraries that are there. So I can have Azure Function core tools downloaded and installed on your system locally, and then using those command line tools, you can create functions and start working with them. So I'm going to do that. So I'm going to go to the command line. I already have those tools installed. And let me go and navigate to my, demo folder. So I have that folder open here. So I'm going to go to a new folder called demo 2. And you'll see this folder is also empty, right? Currently there is nothing in that folder that is created. So I'm just going to. Now, first to check what version of Python I'm actually running, you'll see I have 3.7.4. I also have got the Azure Function core tools installed. Now, the first thing that we'll do is we'll go and initialize a function app. So if you remember, even in Visual Studio Code, it was first created the project. Right. So we are going to go and initialize the function app. So this particular folder, demo folder, is going to become my project folder. Right. So I'm going to go and give now the commands I'm giving are part of Azure Function core tools. Right. So function init, right, will let me initialize a function app, and I'm defining the platform to be Python, right? And if I now check that folder, you'll see there are a lot of files that have automatically got created, right? So if you remember, these are files that we've already seen, right? Host.json, local settings, requirements.txt, gitignore, right? All these are automatically got created when I initialize the function. So function init, and then providing which runtime platform you want to use. Next, you're going to actually go and create the function. So I'm creating a function called classify. So I'm giving the name of the function as classify. So the command is function new, name is classify, and I'm using the template for HTTP trigger. Right, so when we are creating this through Visual Studio Code also, if you remember, we selected which template we want to use. So let me go and create this. And you'll see it has gone and created a folder called classify, which was the function name I specified. And inside that folder, it has gone and created function.json and init file, right? The entry point of my function, correct? Let me go and run this. I can simply do a function start to run the function app. And you'll see it has gone and deployed it to this URL.
Right.
If I go here and try to view this,
क्या कर रही थी यहाँ पे? मसाला निकाल रही थी.
Yeah, and notice is again giving me the same response. So the default code that is deployed to init is that same code. So if I pass name. Notice this time it responds with hello world. Now, this is the default function that is created. Now, we don't really want to do this, right? We want to pass an image of a cat or a dog, and we want to the function to use a machine learning or deep learning model to identify what kind of an image it is, to classify that image either as a cat or a dog, right? So I have some sample images that are there. So let's just try to view one. Right, and similarly I have right, so you're going to try and classify this as a cat or a dog or whatever, right? So to do that, we require the machine learning model, right? So there is a model file that is already created, right? So I'm going to just simply copy the files into my folder, into my, let me stop this. Yeah, and let's give the command. So I already have this file there in my resources folder. So if I go to final demo, outside there is a resources folder where you'll see I have model folder, within which I have this model.pb, which is my actual model file. So this model was exported, it was created and then exported. So I have this model.pb file. I have a label.txt, which also basically gives the text just as cat or dog. Right? I'm deploying these. I'm copying these rather to my function folder. And I also have a helper Python file, which is predict.py, which is actually going to call that model, use that model. Right? So I'm even copying this file to my project folder. Right? So let me copy this. So two files copied, and let me also copy the predict.py. Right. I will explain what is there in predict.py and so on. So we will understand that. Secondly, now my model is created using TensorFlow. So I need my environment where my function is going to execute the model, or my Python code is going to execute for that function. I need that environment to have the appropriate libraries loaded, right? So remember, we have a requirements.txt file, which lets us define what the target environment should have, what libraries it should have. So I'm going to simply go and update that file. I go to demos 2, requirements.txt. So along with Azure functions, I'm also going to have these installed, right? So I'll save this. The next thing that I need to do is create the virtual environment. So if I want to run it locally, right? If I have to do this, I need to go and create the virtual environment in Python so that I can have all this environment that I need, all the libraries that I need installed in that virtual environment. So as long as the virtual environment is running, that is there. Once I stop that environment, deactivate it, it will go away, right? So I can do that. I'll come to that a little later. So let's create this environment. And then I'll activate the environment. Can you see it's already in that virtual environment now? Okay. Now, once I've activated, I can go and configure that environment with whatever libraries I need, which are defined in my requirements.txt file. Right? And you'll see that it's going and downloading the appropriate libraries. Yeah, so it's downloading Azure functions, it's downloading TensorFlow, and so on. Right? Now, while this is happening, let's go and actually modify our init file to call the appropriate or have the appropriate code which will invoke the classification model. So going back to my helper files, I'm going to open this. And what I'll do is I'll go and open that init file, which is by default created in my function called classify. Let me open this file with Visual Studio Code. Let me close this folder so you don't get confused. So now let me open it. And this was the default init file that we get with a template, right? So I'm going to modify this. So in this case, it was just in importing the login package and the Azure Functions package, right? Now I need to change this. I'm going to modify this to import logging and Azure Functions. Definitely, I'm also importing JSON package. And then I'm saying that from the current folder, from the package called predict, from the file called predict, import the function called predict image from URL. Right? So if you remember, I had copied this file called predict.py. So let's open this also with Visual Studio Code so that we understand what is happening. So I'm loading this file and importing this function from this file. Okay. Now let me modify the main function. Right, and this is what my main function is going to contain. Now let's understand this. We are going to get an image URL. So we are expecting a parameter called img. Like in the earlier function, we were getting a parameter called name. In this case, we are expecting a parameter called img, which is going to be containing the URL of the image that we want to process, right? It's just logging which image was received. And then it's going to go and get the results by calling this function called predict image from URL. Where is this function? It's in this Python file called predict, which is locally there in my function project, right? Whatever is the result of this call, right? I'm going to create a header, right? And I'm going to return that as that result as an HTTP response. So I'm returning a JSON document. The results I'm going to return as JSON. Is this clear? Right? Very simple. Now the actual code lies in this predict.py, right? So if you look at predict.py, right, first thing what it's doing is it's loading the model file, right? So it's first getting the absolute path of the folder where that code is running. From there, it is getting the path to model.pv, which is the actual model file, right? And in a function called initialize, right? In the function called initialize, that file is getting loaded. So that model is getting loaded in memory so that it can be used. So the initialize function is loading the model into memory, right? And then there is a function called predict image from URL, which is receiving an image URL as parameter. And what it's simply doing is it's calling initialize, which is the method we saw. And then it is actually calling another in private method called predict image, where it is simply passing that image. So it's from the URL, it's opening that image, getting the stream of that image, and it's passing that image stream. right? And this predict image from URL is what we are calling from init. Now, predict image from URL is actually called in predict image. And predict image is basically using the model that we have loaded. What type of image it is. So this is where it is generating the response, right? And it's creating it as a JSON object where it's going to return created, predicted tag name. So what is the prediction it's making? And what is the accuracy of that prediction? So the result of that prediction. Okay, so these are the files that are going to get used. Now, before we can actually test this, we'll have to, like I said, prepare the environment. Right now, that environment is prepared, right? We've installed all the appropriate libraries that are required. We have the function code also ready in that environment, right? So we can now simply go and run that. Simply go and run that or start that function. Let me do a function start. And we've got the function getting hosted here, right? Let me try to invoke it. Now this time, what it's going to expect as parameter, this is, we copy this. What it's going to expect as parameter is the image, right? And I'm passing it this image, which is cat1.png. And you'll notice this return the JSON value where it's giving me the created time. The predicted tag name is cat. So it's predicting it's a cat. And it's saying the accuracy, prediction accuracy probability is 1. Right? Accuracy or probability will always be between 0 and 1. Closer to 1, that means the accuracy is higher. Over here it's saying like it's definitely sure it's a sing. Right, let's copy this URL also and try to predict. So I'm just changing the URL. To dog. And now notice predicted tag name is dog. And it's again returned a probability of. Right, so I'm actually got the model hosted inside my Azure function and it is running inside that Azure function. Oh, the image path is a remote path, so it's an HTTP path URL that I'm providing. So now let's try actually running this using a demo client application, right? So I'm again going to my demo2 folder. So I've opened another command prompt. I'm navigating to that folder. There is a folder called frontend. And if you see this folder, there is a HTML file. So it's basically going to be an HTML application that is going to run. So it'll give me a simple UI to enter the URL of the image and it will let me make a prediction and display it, right? So I'm going to run the environment over here also. So I'm going to run this. So let me activate the Python environment, right? And then I'm going to run the web server. Activate the web server on the web server package. So it's now listening on port 80, right? And I have that HTML file there. So let me go to this port. Local host colon 1000, and I have a simple UI which asking me to enter the image URL. So let me go and give another URL. It's a cat2. So this is the URL image. Let me submit this. So submit will go and call the function. Yeah, and my prediction has come back saying it is a cat. Let's try one more. Let's try dog too. And it has come back with the prediction it's a dog. Okay. So let's look at the code for this application. It's a simple, like I said, web app. So first is, of course, some header, some CSS files and so on that are included. And this is the main body section. Right, where it has the text box and the button and so on, right? And this is where it's going and calling. So there is a base URL called localhost colon 7071, right? It's on submit of the button, it's calling this method, which is basically going and to the base URL is going and adding this API slash classify. And to that is going to add a image query string parameter with this dot URL. So if you look at the UI, the text box which is there, okay, has the name as URL. So the model is created over here. It's using Bootstrap, so it's used the URL. So it is passing that URL as a query string parameter, right? And it's getting the results based on that function, right? Whatever is the results, right? It's binding it to this, that is binding it back to this form. And here you can see the results are bound. So based on whether it's a cat or a dog, which is returned as a predicted tag name, it is displaying the appropriate header in the application. Is this clear? So simple UI, simple web application to test it. Yes, we can share that. I don't know about sharing of the material. That is something that Priyanka and team will get back to you. But I can guide you where you can actually try out this demo. So you can share that with you in the thank you mail that we send you. Now the same function that I've created, I can go and deploy again to Azure and I can get it running in Azure. So I've already done that. Right, so let me just show you. So on Azure, I have created a function app. And in this case, in the earlier example that I've shown you deploying to Azure, I deployed the direct Python code. But in this case, I've actually deployed a container. So I have packaged my project into a container image and then use the container image to deploy. So let me show you that. How do I do that? So I'll just stop this. So if you remember when we created the function init, right? I can also pass a parameter called Docker. Right? Now when I pass a parameter called Docker in that app project that is created, you'll see that a Docker file also has got added. Okay. If I open this in Visual Studio Code, okay, so this file contains all the code that is required to build the Docker container. Right? So it will ensure that the environment is created. It will ensure that the environment is installed using requirements.txt and so on. Right? So this will actually go and create the Docker image and then I can deploy that Docker image. So what I have done is I have built this and I have deployed it in my Docker account. So let me just show you that. And you'll see over here, can you see this one? This is the image that I created as your function image. Right? And this is what I deployed to Azure Function App. So I deployed my function to Azure Function App as a Docker image. So I packaged it as an image, Docker image, and I deployed the Docker image. And this is the function I have created. So if I just get the URL of this function. So actually, if you look at that code that was there in the front end, actually had the base URL set to this. Right, so it is actually set it to classification. So when I ran the when I ran this application, it's actually running it and calling the function which is hosted on Azure using container. And inside the container, my model code is running. Okay. So any questions? So with this, I end the session. If you have any questions, do feel free to ask and drop us a mail also. I'll just share my email ID also with you.
Thank you so much, Ashwini ma'am, for a such a wonderful session, and thanks everyone for joining today's session. Also, we are having tomorrow and hands-on Python workshop. So I'm going to share here the attendee link. So if you, any one of you want to attend tomorrow's workshop, please use that link for the for attending the workshop. Once again, thank you everyone for joining the session today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Guys, also we are going to send the feedback form. So please fill that and give us your precious feedback so we can improve. And once you fill the feedback form, you will get the participation certificate. And for the recordings, visit our YouTube channel. I will share the YouTube channel's link here.